Welcome to the channel, Frank. Today we're going to talk about mental models and how they can be useful for your life. So why don't you give us a super high-level overview of like what mental models are and how we can and how we're going to explain them today?
This is my favorite topic, Mitchell, so I'm really excited to be here talking to you about it.
Yeah, welcome.
Mental models is something that I stumbled upon because I was trying to figure out how to take all the information around me in the world and make sense of it. And I felt like people around me were doing that much better. They had really strong opinions about public policy, education, healthcare. And I was always, I'd say, informed, but I was always on the fence, right? People around me were thinking in black and white, and I thought the world was more gray, and that bothered me, made me feel a little bit stupid. So I think the two tools that really helped me make more sense of the world around me were mental models and data analytics.
Awesome. Maybe give us an example of what a mental model is, or like how would you describe it in like a very basic way for someone?
My most basic description of a mental model is a way to think about the world.
Awesome.
There's a lot of information out there. Organizing it in different ways and making sense of it is a mental model. For example, the easiest example I can think of is opportunity cost, which comes from economics.
Yeah.
Opportunity cost is the cost associated with not doing something. An example I've seen you use in your videos is going to college. You can go to college for 4 years, incur student loans, learn what you want to learn about so that you can become whatever it is you want to be. At the same time, there's an opportunity cost associated, right? The student loans isn't the only thing. Instead of going to college, you can work for 4 years, right? Let's say you make $20,000 a year for those 4 years. That's $80,000 you're foregoing or you're passing up,
exactly.
Right? What is the cost of the alternative that you are passing up?
Yeah, that's awesome. It's like that mental model, specifically opportunity cost, is like one of the most neglected ideas or concepts. So mental models can like bring like to problems and help us solve things and understand things in a better way.
Yeah, for sure. They can put structure around your information.
Yeah.
One of the best ways I've found to practice mental models, because if it's not readily available to you, when you're making a decision, you might forget about it, right? It could be in your notebook or back in a textbook. If you don't practice with them, you might not have it readily available. So my favorite way to practice is to take mental models, put it together with data analytics, grab some open source data out there in the world, and start looking through the data, and then trying to apply those models to what I'm seeing in the graphs and charts and aggregate data sets.
Awesome, so let's do that then.
Yeah, perfect. So what I'd like to start out with is a data set that I pulled from Kaggle. It is an HR data set. And I'll start out with the question, how do companies grow? If we have a startup company, there's a lot of complexity there, right? There's a lot of things going on. The question is, well, how is it going to grow? What is the first few months going to look like? What's the first few years going to look like?
Excellent. All right.
So looking a little bit further at this data set, we can start with a very blank slate. And this is my favorite way to do it. I want to be thinking about it before I pull data, before I pull the actual numbers. So what we have here is, first of all, a data set, and you can think of a spreadsheet where you have rows of data, and each row represents an employee that worked at the company. And it gives you characteristics about those employees. Start date, end date, termination reason, they were terminated. It has their pay rate, demographic information. So all of this stuff that you can extract. And from that, you can see over time how many employees worked at the company.
Awesome. So you can see the change over time. What happened when we were one person all the way up to hundreds of people.
Exactly. So using data analytics, you can pull that out and you can plot it. And what we'll end up seeing is that we have down here on this axis, we have date, right? And it goes from about 2005 to about 2020. So 15 years worth of data.
Yep.
And then we have employee count on the y-axis or the vertical axis.
Yep.
So before I put actual data on there, if you're thinking about a company growing and you're thinking about the people, why don't you take a guess on what that looks like? What is this going to look like as we plot it?
I would say generally, as the company grows, there's more people. So as time goes on, we have a higher employee count.
That's logical, right?
That
makes sense. So one way to think about it is that it's a straight line.
Yeah.
Every single year, let's say we add 25 employees.
Exactly.
First year, we hire 25. Second year, we hire 25. Third year, 20, so on and so forth.
Yep.
And that's really a linear growth rate. So you go from 25 employees to 50 to 75 to 100. And that's what you see here.
So linear is simply like a straight line, a growth that could be expressed with a straight line that doesn't change very much.
That's it. Another example outside of this of linear growth is the further something is away, the longer it's going to take me to drive there.
Awesome.
Right? Linear relationship.
Yeah.
Linear relationships are very easy to think about. They simplify the world for us. The problem is that a lot of relationships are not linear.
Exactly.
Right? The line won't be this straight. Why don't we look at the data and see what the line actually looks like?
Yeah, I don't think that's linear right away. Probably not.
Nope. Going from your linear line to this, you could see it's not a linear relationship.
Yeah, for sure.
Instead, what we see is a relatively slow growth rate at first, right?
Yep.
So the first, let's say 2005 to 2010, it's pretty flat, actually.
Exactly.
But then something happens. There's a catalyst. And that catalyst drives growth of employees and drives growth of the company. And you can see that rapid increase in growth rate. And then at some point, it tails off up here, right? And we slow down again.
Awesome. So you could describe that as roughly an S-shaped growth curve.
Yeah.
Boom, the catalyst, and then it kind of plateaus out and stays consistent or more flat. Yeah.
Yeah, perfect. So let's
do
put
that.
A general pattern over the actual data. So the actual data is here in blue.
Yeah.
But then if we put a general pattern, we have what Mitchell referred to as that S-curve growth rate.
Awesome.
Which is fantastic because we see that in a lot of different places in the world. It's not just with company growth rate. We see it with fashion trend growth rates. We see it with technology growth rates.
Yeah.
And we also see it with personal growth rates and things we're doing, which we'll get into in a sec.
Awesome.
What's really important is there's two pivotal moments here. The first is when growth ramps up, right? And if we look at that point, right, so we have the yellow line now, this is the place where growth goes from slow to fast. There's some catalysts that happen. It could be a million different reasons, right?
Yeah,
there
yeah.
could be a ton of stuff that drives that. One way to think about that is it's either demand-driven or supply-driven. Every market has two sides, right? Supply and demand. The demand, something could have happened on social media that made people aware of this company or the company's product or the company's service, and then they needed to hire people really fast to meet that demand. Could be supply side, right? The demand might have been there already, but if this is a product company, well, maybe the manufacturing capabilities of the company were able to ramp up, and then boom, 2011 hits and they were ready to sell. So they had to scale up, right? The people at the company.
So it's like the point where it goes from being slow to exploding and kind of really accelerating and pushing that S up. Awesome.
Yeah. So if you're planning, right? So think if you're planning and you're planning for a linear growth rate, you are going to be caught way off guard.
Exactly.
When this hits, right?
Yeah, because this is where the linear rate really cranks up and like explodes. Like when Amazon becomes the online company everyone uses or says in their house, or like when cars are all over the streets versus just like one car in town. This is like the explosion that kind of generates everybody.
Yep.
Everybody's interest.
Yeah.
Awesome.
It's important. So the
second part. Yeah. Tell us about the second half.
The second point that's the second growth rate change that's really important is, let's say, over here. And if we move our yellow line to over there, this is where growth starts to tail off.
Yes.
Right? Things aren't moving as fast. We don't need to hire as many employees. And this is called the point of diminishing returns or diminishing marginal returns.
Yep.
Where effectively you could keep hiring and hiring and hiring, but each person you're hiring isn't adding as much value as the people that are already there, or the people that you just hired.
Yeah, got it. So it's really where it starts to even off, where like as there's only so many people in the world, there are only so many people that can buy coffee at your coffee shop. And once you kind of meet that number, you kind of start to plateau and your progress isn't as great or isn't as fast, but you're really popular, right?
Exactly. I really liked your example of Coca-Cola.
Yeah.
Right? Let's say at first, however many years ago, nobody was drinking Coca-Cola, and then it started to ramp up and then faster and faster and faster. And if there comes a point where every single person in the world is drinking Coca-Cola, and given that we're more health conscious now, I don't know.
Yeah, it's kind of starting to plateau off. Like the S curve has already shot up to popularity.
And it's already at the other side.
Yeah. So unless we sell Coca-Cola to aliens or dogs or, I don't know, animals, there's no other market for it. So it's just kind of at the top of the S curve and either going down or staying flat.
The market's saturated. Absolutely.
Got it.
Before we leave the S curve, I want to focus on the first part of it.
Yep.
Because I think this is really interesting.
Let's dive in. If we look
at the first part of it within this green box, my favorite example to look at is what I call 1% better.
Yeah. So what does that mean, 1% better?
So if you can get 1% better every single day at anything you do, do you think that is a good strategy for personal growth?
I think groin is better, yes. But when you put it that way, it sounds very underwhelming. Like, if you tell your parents they're going to improve your grades by 1% like per day, or like 1%, they're not going to be very happy with you.
Yeah, it sounds like a small
yeah.
thing to go after. But the truth is 1% every day over time adds up to massive gains.
Yeah.
So the example here is that if you can get 1% better over 365 days of the year, you start out at that end of the curve.
Yeah, yeah.
Very small improvement every day. But at the end of the year, you end up with great improvement.
Awesome. That's crazy. It's kind of like you take little steps here that don't add up to much. But after all that progress happens and after you continue to compound that, you get better and better. And those little steps become really big steps.
Yeah.
Awesome.
If you start out at an arbitrary skill level of 10,
yeah,
1% on 10 is 0.1.
Yeah.
It's negligible.
Yeah.
And that's why over the first 30 days, right in this chart, you only gain 3.3 proficiency points in the first 30 days, which is very small. But yeah. the truth is 1% on 300, right? Huge. In the chart, if you're at level of 300, you're gaining 1% times 300 is 3.
Yeah.
So that's 3 proficiency points in just one day, right?
Which is way more than the first
30 days to get 3 points. And now just in one day, you're gaining that. So the whole point here, and really the mental model, shows us that at the beginning, if you can stay disciplined and execute every single day and just get a little bit better every single day, at the end of that cycle, there will be massive reward.
Yeah. What I love about this mental model is it's like, how can you focus on the early gains or the early wins? And if you just keep doing that, you get much better. And I think a lot of people, maybe we make different decisions in our lives. If we know if we can just get a little bit better each day and keep doing that, we'll be somewhere way better in the future. I think that's like a really good life principle brought to life with the data you brought.
Yeah.
So it's a great example.
Excellent.